This morning, we have another guest preacher. Last week was Dave Runyon as he talked about neighboring. This week, we have Brian Gray. Brian's been a close friend for the past 10 years or so. Brian is the COO of a ministry, nonprofit organization here in town called Denver Institute of Faith and Work. And the idea is how do we serve God in our work, in the places where God has called us into? And so as we look at this series, Proclaiming the Kingdom, one of the ways as we've looked at through this series is Proclaiming the Kingdom is not only the way we live our lives, but as a community, how we plant churches. Last week, how we live and neighbor with one another. But then today we're going to be looking at how do we proclaim the kingdom in light of the place where we work. And so Brian, as he's the COO of Denver Institute of Faith and Work, he also oversees the fellowship program and does great work there. He has been a local pastor for about 13 years, served at the seminary for approximately 4 to 5 years, Denver Seminary, and now he has been at Denver Institute for the past 2 years. This is a passion that he holds, and it is a gift for us as a community to be able to hear what the Lord has to say to us through his word as Brian is an ambassador. So Brian, why don't you come forward? Let's pray for you, brother, as you talk about our vocation and our calling in the workplace. Jesus, we want to thank you for Brian, and we want to thank you, Lord, for the ministry that you have placed upon his life. We thank you for his work at the seminary, for the work at the local congregational level, and then also, especially now, as he is helping to lead this organization. We want to pray, Lord, that you will speak to our hearts as he proclaims your word. Be with him, Jesus. Anoint him with your Holy Spirit. You set him apart for this great purpose. And Lord, soften our hearts where our hearts need to be softened. Lord, as your word is shared, we ask, Jesus, that you do a special work in us and through us, your people, today, we pray. Bless and anoint Brian. It's in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Well, good morning. Anglicans. Actually respond to you when you talk. Good. We're going to put that into practice a little bit here. I want you to be thinking about a question this morning. What is it that you wanted to be when you grew up? If you were to think back as a kid, it's a really common question we ask our kids, people who are graduating high school and thinking about college, picking a major, are sitting on this question. College grads who come out and are thinking about the question again. What is it that you wanted to be when you grew up? I grew up in a very conservative, fundamentalist Christian heritage, I would say. And so my grandparents were entirely freaked out when, as a seven-year-old, I announced that I wanted to be a bartender. This is my first major career aspiration, and the reason was Uncle Bud was a bartender in Santa Barbara. For those of you not familiar, grew up in California, for those of you not familiar, UC Santa Barbara is basically a gigantic fraternity party that can basically confers liberal arts degrees on the side. And so my Uncle Bud was very cool. I wanted to be like him. He was a bartender, my first career aspiration. Let's say you meet someone at a social event, right? Any kind of setting, or you meet people in public. What's one of the first questions you go to? Yeah, what do you do, right? We're culture, where you seem to be hung up on this question of what do you do, but I'd suggest that maybe the more intriguing question is, why do you do? And so I've just started throwing people off, but hey, so why do you do what you do? And just start asking. And it's the question I want to sit with today. Let's imagine you wanted to be an astronaut when you grew up because you saw the first landing on the moon. What was it about that? Was it bravery? Was it adventure? Was it a sense of exploration? Was it the advancement of science? What was it that drew you to being an astronaut? If you wanted to be a teacher, I'm far more curious why you wanted to be a teacher than the fact that you did. And it's probably because some other teacher taught you something. They blew your mind. They helped you to understand something in a new way that you didn't before. So you thought, I want to do that for others, right? So hold on to this question of why do you do what you do, because we're going to return to it at the end today. Here's what I want to do. Today I want to talk about, in essence, the why of our work and how it fits within the mission of God, okay? The why of our work. So we'll do three things. First, I want to give us really quick common ground, so when we're talking about work, we're talking about the same thing. We'll take a look at this passage that might, as you heard 1 Thessalonians 4 read today, it's a little bit of a head-scratcher, at least. So we'll talk about that passage, and Paul's why behind we should work. And then we'll wrap by talking about the idea of work as a vocation and why it matters for later this afternoon or even for tomorrow morning. So let me start with a little common ground on work. A couple different things. First of all, work, despite any types of cultural narratives, work is first and foremost, is good and is a blessing from God. So if we read in Genesis, work exists before the fall. We have in Genesis 1:28, in essence, the great cultural mandate is what it's known as. So God, who himself created and cultivates, gives to humanity, all of humanity, the purpose of now go and create and cultivate. And the context of that in Genesis 1:28 is, and he blessed them and said, go create and cultivate. And so the original context for work is, despite what it feels like and despite what our motivations are, it was intended by God for all of human purpose to be good and to be an aspect of blessing. Certainly in the fall, impacted by, tainted by rebellion and frustration, right? By the sweat of your brow, you will work the ground, thistles and thorns, but intended originally as good. A second thing, so we have to hold on to that. A second piece as we talk about work is when we're talking about work biblically, we're not necessarily intending just work as pay. Again, Anglicans, a little audience participation here, right? If my W-2 job is preparing food, what would you call me? Chef, yeah, or somebody said a cook, right? If I clean office buildings or clean homes, what would you call me?
Custodian.
Yeah, custodian, a janitor, I think I heard from somebody. Right? So people, we pay someone to take care of my daughters one day a week. What would we call that person?
Daycare.
Yeah, nanny, daycare, etc. Okay? And if you cook or if you clean or if you take care of the children and you don't get paid, what do we call you? Y'all are sexist. We call you a parent. God, let's switch. We got to switch to a new sermon topic today. Point taken, though, does anybody actually want to, I mean, simple exercise to say, does anybody want to take issue today that being a parent or particularly being a mom is not work? I'll give, it's all you. You come on up, you take a crack. So the point is that we need to think about work more broadly than just work for pay or remuneration, particularly because the scriptures are thinking about this. So I'd put forward a definition of work that would be helpful that would be basically all service that's done in the interest in service of our own needs and the needs of others is a great way to think about work, okay? So it's originally intended as good. It expands beyond our jobs and what we get paid for. And just a final piece is we probably overlook what a constant occurrence work is in the scriptures. If you were to look just at the teaching of Jesus in the parables, 86% of his parables are about or within the context of work, right? And so one of the reasons it's easy for us to miss, I suspect, is because for most of our types of work today, they're different than the types of work that happened scripturally. In the context of the Old Testament, and even in the New Testament times, work is predominantly either agrarian, right, or it's subsistence types of work. And that's very different. Does anyone here either in farming or agrarian type of work? Okay, by that show of hands. Does anyone here do something that they would categorize as either thought work or service work or information work today, by show of hands? So we have to do a little bit of translation from thistles and thorns to what does that mean, and the answer is an email inbox, right, in our modern culture. And so work is a very predominant feature, but I think it's easy for us to overlook, and we actually have to do some translation into our modern context. So just leveling the playing field, when we're talking about work, this is what we're talking about today. So then Paul, in this passage, Paul is addressing, in essence, the why of our work. What we didn't read today, let me go back a verse or two and give you the context to set up some of Paul's thinking. If we were to read chapter 3, verse 12. So basically, first of all, Paul has preached himself into a lot of trouble. He's been run out of town, and he's left relatively new converts from paganism in Thessalonica without pastoral leadership. And so he's writing a letter back to Thessalonica, encouraging them, and his basic message is everyday spirituality. What does it look like to love God and love others in kind of the common and the everyday? Chapter 3, verse 12, he says, "May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you." Okay, this is the first thing. So even those who are persecuting in your faith, what's it look like for you to love each other and to love one another outside? In chapter 4, verse 1, he says, as for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. And now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. Okay, so there's two dimensions to set up this passage today. He's really thinking in terms of what does it look like to love one another in relationships inside the church, to love those who are outside the church, and to love God. Do these seem like familiar words, perhaps from another reading that we had this morning as the cross was led into the middle of our community, right? And so in essence, I'd suggest that Paul is just operating out of a very common paradigm, which was the greatest commandment. What does it look like to love the Lord God with our heart, soul, and mind, love our neighbor as ourselves? Jesus said, in fact, all of the law and prophets hang on these types of things, on these two dimensions. And so I want you to hold on to those things as I'm going to reread, focusing on verses 9 through 12, and I just want you to keep in mind the concept of Paul's background of loving God and loving others in the common and the everyday. Okay? Verse 9, now about your love for one another, we do not need to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all of God's family through Macedonia. Yet we urge you, brothers and sisters, to do so more and more. And here's where it gets a little head scratcher, to make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so that you will not be dependent upon anyone. Okay, if I were to give you two very small pieces of context culturally, I think it can pull out a helpful understanding of this passage, and it really occurs on two different divides that are happening culturally. And the first one is a secular and a sacred divide. So in that culture, there would be certain things that, I'm superimposing, these might not have been the words that were used, but certain things were sacred, they were important, and other things were secular, or they were more common. Okay, this has its roots actually in Greek philosophy. Doug Grotius asked if he could inject a 45-minute lecture on Platonic philosophy at this point. And I might summarize it in this way. In that culture, in those days, if you were to stand on the steps and pontificate, or to think, or to philosophize, this would be considered a higher order, something that is, if I can superimpose the word, sacred, something that is spiritual and more lofty. But if you installed the steps, if you built them with your hands, this was common and everyday, and was looked upon more lowly, okay? So think about that first divide. Because actually, in Christian circles, we have our own version, and it goes like this. I'm going to give you four jobs, and I want you to think about them in terms of their spiritual significance, a phrase I will not define, okay? So just in your mind, I'm going to give you four jobs. How would most Christians rank these 1 through 4 in terms of their spiritual significance, okay? A CEO of, let's say, a pharmaceutical company, a teacher at a Christian school, a plumber, and let's say a senior pastor of an Anglican church in Inglewood. Okay? For example. So if I get, right, a CEO at a medical tech company, pharmaceutical company, a Christian school teacher, a plumber, senior pastor. Think of how most Christians would rank those. And I would suggest, even if you want to submit, that is a horrible question, and I reject it. Praise God for you. That is the right answer. Okay? But most people could just line those things up. And there's something right here that is very sacred. And then that Christian school teacher, at least they're in a Christian environment. Now, I don't know what on earth to do with the CEO of the farm company, because pharmaceuticals is making my health insurance cross awful. So I don't know how to categorize that. And I don't know what to do with the plumber, because it's like step building. Fair or not, I'd suggest deeply unfair. There's a way that we tend to triage things, and we think of certain things as more spiritually significant than others. And I'd suggest that this type of divide between a sacred and a secular is sitting within the thinking of people in that culture, right? Second divide is this, and this divide is that which is public truth and that which is private truth. Now, that might be a little bit more predominant for us today, but I want you to think that there's an old illustration or analogy made very popular by Francis Schaeffer. And it worked like this. If you come over to my house, I live in a two-story home. And if you also live in a two-story home, it is probably similarly designed in terms of architectural features. If you are on the bottom floor of my home, right? That's pretty normal. If you're hanging out in the kitchen or the family room, I'll have friends over today to watch the Super Bowl. Bottom floor of the house, totally normal. If I come upstairs and I find you in the master bedroom, real awkward, right? Really strange. In other words, my home is actually designed with private space and public space. And most homes are. And a very common narrative of that which is true, particularly today, is that there are certain things which are private and they belong in the private sphere. And your beliefs, sisters and brothers, are there. But don't let them come out here into the public space. Don't let them have any kind of say whatsoever on governmental policy or the way we might think about immigration reform, the way we would be motivated towards addressing issues in affordable housing and gentrification in the city. In other words, those beliefs belong in the private, what's good for you is good for you space, not what's good for us is good for us space. So I want to suggest that there's two divides, and Paul is contending against both of those in this passage. So if you think about the two divides, that there are certain things which are sacred and they're really important, if I can Christianize this, important to God in terms of spiritual significance, certain things less so, and certain things belong in public and certain things just belong in private. If you think about those two divides, then verse 11 and 12, I'd suggest, are contending against them. The first divide is in verse 11. Make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we told you. This is actually the raising up and the elevating of the person who would have built those steps. This is Paul contextually. He's contending against this dualistic structure where certain things are more noble and they're more important in that culture and others aren't. So to work with your hands would have been looked down upon, and he's elevating that. He's saying, no, that's actually important. That's important to God. And then the why behind that, I'd suggest, begins to contend against this public and private truth divide. In verse 12, he says, work with your hands so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders and so that you will not be dependent upon anyone. Remember the context overall is, what does it look like to please God? What does it look like to love other people? And he said, in essence, take your work very seriously, win the respect of outsiders. So in the overall context of love God, love others, I'd suggest that Paul is saying here that good work well done would cross these two divides, or in essence, work is a function of worship and service, right? Sitting behind this passage, this is a very strange passage, unless we could think more big picture in terms of the greatest commandment. In essence, work is a function of loving God, worshiping God, and serving and loving others. But let me connect that here as a final thought to the idea of vocation. Now, I said earlier we're going to talk about, just get some common ground on work, talk about the way Paul is thinking about the why here. We'll return to that in a second. But what I want to suggest is that work for all of us, work of all types, not just for a paycheck, work is actually our vocation. Now, that might sound like doublespeak to some of you, because if we were to define vocation, most commonly held understanding of that in our culture would be like occupation or career field, right? And so, if I say work is your vocation, that's like, well, yeah, work is your career, work is your employment. It's like, well, that's redundant. But a couple things. I gave you a quick list of some common ground on work. Let me do the same thing with this idea of vocation. Vocation is a theological word. It is not a cultural word. It comes from Latin roots of vox, which means voice, or vocare, which is to summons. And so vocation actually means calling. So I want to suggest I use this word because you'll hear it all the time. We talk about vocational school, and people, if they ever use this, it's this lofty career arcing kind of concept. Friends, that is a theological word, and it has its roots relationally in a person whose life is in submission to the voice and the summons of God. Okay? Applied for 45, 50 hours a week or in places beyond that outside of their work as a calling. So, first of all, I would suggest that work is a calling. I'd suggest, second, that all Christians have a calling, not just some people in certain religious organizations or religious types of jobs. That's where it's most commonly applied. It would probably not be weird if Katie described, or David or Billy described, a sense of calling to the type of work that they do. we probably don't hear that as commonly from the CEO of the farm company or the plumber, right? But I said that this is a major problem biblically, and this is part of that dualistic divide. So in the Reformation, one of the key theological features of the Reformation was the idea of the priesthood of all believers, okay? So back in the day, the same divide existed in the church. And so we would say certain people were called by God, and they were capital R religious. They were the priests, the monks, and the nuns. They lived a cloistered life reserved for a special devotion and commitment unto Christ, okay? And then there's all the rest of us, the butchers, the bakers, the candlestick makers, and we're over here, okay? This is called the religious life. And so emerging in the Reformation is this idea, we do not mean to be religious, capital R, but we mean to live religiously. Taking that type of sacred devotion and dynamism in the whole of life and applying it to the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker. So William Perkins is this, he was on the Protestant side of the development of the Church of England and the Protestant Catholic debates, and more than just debates, in the Church of England in the Protestant Reformation. But listen to this, listen to the way he phrases this, okay? William Perkins says a vocation or calling, synonyms, is a certain kind of life ordained and imposed on man by God for the common good. Every person of every degree, state, sex, or condition, without exception, must have some personal and particular calling to walk in. The main end of our lives is to serve. Okay, so I'd suggest first that work is a calling. Second is that all Christians have a calling. And finally, calling is primarily about what we share in common as followers of Jesus, more than some individualistic Western mentality of a statement that I've written down, perhaps in an executive coaching relationship. I don't mean this as any knock towards that industry, but we have a very individualized and individualistic understanding of calling today. But I would say calling is primarily unto Christ, and it's primarily that which we share in common. So you know the classic journalistic questions, who, what, where, why, when, yeah? Calling is very rarely about what you do and where you do it. It is predominantly about who you are. And let me pluralize this, who we are, how we are living, why we are living. So a primary sense of calling is unto Christ, and it's answering questions about our who, our why, and our how. And then, this is not to take away from vox, vocare, calling God, individually leading people, but it's only secondarily addressing questions for the individual of what I do and where I do it. These just aren't as interesting of questions to the scriptures, it would seem. So pulling this together, we talked about this greatest commandment, that you are to love God, we are to love God and love others as our primary motivation. I'd suggest that that is the best biblical definition of calling that would unite all of us together. And it's in that spirit, let me offer you an understanding of calling from Oz Guinness. And think about this in terms of the whole of our lives. Oz says, God calls us to himself, right, relationally. Not to Denver or Delhi or Detroit, not to architecture or something else, but God calls us to himself so decisively that everything we are, everything we do, everything we have is invested with special devotion and dynamism, lived out as a response to his summons. This is whole life stewardship. The entirety of our lives, the whole of our lives, a massive function of which is our work. So I want to suggest that work is smaller than our calling. It's included and pulled into our calling. And we need to understand our work, therefore, as what it means to love God, worship God, and to serve the world. I mean, this is a very Hebrew way of thinking. So in Hebrew, there is a word avodah. And they would use the word avodah, or the family of words that came out of it, to be both about work, but also in other places, this word family would be about worship, or this word family would be about service, or even craftsmanship in the arts. So there's this very unified way in which the Hebrews are thinking about this idea of whole life worship. Similarly, we're proclaiming the kingdom as this series, right? John Stott, another good Anglican, said early on in his career, if he was to say, what does it mean to be about Christian mission, he would take you to the Great Commission. right, to make disciples of all the earth. But he said later on in his career, he had changed his mind. He would said he would primarily take us to John 20:21, as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. So that our mission is primarily our sentness, and our sentness is in the way that Jesus was sent. Right? So before we necessarily superimpose back an evangelism-only understanding of that, what would it mean for the people of God to be sent in a Jewish or Hebrew culture? It would mean they were to be the community of God, how they were to live, priesthood of all believers. They were to be a certain type of holy people. They were to serve the rest of the world, and, but not exclusively, they were to proclaim the reality of who Yahweh, who God was. And so the sending of Jesus is both to be the visible presence of God, to serve humanity, and to proclaim the kingdom coming. And I want to suggest that our work can sit in this tradition. Now, all I did this morning was give you a why. And if we wanted to start to talk about how, there's no way we could do that in a homily. In fact, I lead what's called the 5280 Fellowship. It's a 9-month leadership and spiritual formation program for full-time professionals. And we answer this question: what does it mean to give the whole of who we are in response to God's calling through our work in service of critical needs in the city? Okay, so while we can't answer that, I would leave you with perhaps one practice that in time may begin to help you to answer, how is my work an aspect of mission? And that is a very simple breath prayer. What does this mean tomorrow morning? If you find yourself in a cube at about this time at 9:45, what does this mean then? What does it mean this afternoon as you're attending to the needs of kids and others? And I would simply pause routinely and regularly throughout the day and open your ears and your sense of presence to the voice of God in that very activity in which you find yourself. 1 minute of prayerful silence before picking up the kids after school. 1 minute of prayerful silence before you move into the meeting where there's going to be the exchange of ideas, perhaps the critique of your own ideas. 1 minute of silence before you respond to that email, and simply sit with the breath prayer, Father, how do you want me to love you and serve others right now? How do you want me to love you and serve others right now? That sounds so terribly simple. And at the same time, I'd suggest if we build the habit and the routine of this type of breath prayer moved into this type of action, we will find ourselves answering with our lives over time the question of, how is my work an aspect of God's mission? We live it as a calling. We live it in response to his voice, loving him and serving others. Wellspring, I'd suggest this divided city needs you to embrace and to live out a vocation of love through the majority of what you will be doing with your waking hours. Because there's actually a very great divide between people and Jesus in the city. And the current reputation of Christianity in the United States is unfavorable, to say the least. And in particularly because of the political climate, fair or not fair, that they say that we created. So listen, this is a greatly divided culture, and we're on one side of the divide. And I'd suggest, in the words of Paul and the words of Jesus, a way to cross over that is to simply live our lives as calling in everything that we do, in particular our work. What does it mean to worship him and to serve others? Because no one's going to argue with you about being loved well and served well. Not your children, not your coworkers, not your clients, not your neighbors. So I commend this simple practice to be the people of God, to embody the message, and to proclaim through a life well lived. Amen.